Colleagues, I would like to start. Can I invite the rapporteur to join us on the podium? Mrs. Morvai has a point of order before we start.
Yes, Madam Chair, I do have a point of order, and that point of order is that I think it should be considered a necessity that maybe these inquiry proceedings should just be cancelled due to the lack of interest on the part of members of the European Parliament. If the camera turns around and shows to the European taxpayers how their resources are spent, how many empty seats are there, when the Tavares report was on the podium about Hungary, then everybody was here. Now nobody is here. There are all these whistleblowers and the people who risk their life in order that we can find out what happened, all these major human rights violations. I think it's a disaster that it seems that about 10% of the members are interested. I'm a non-attached member. I have no right to go with the delegation to Washington to take part in the
okay,
in the work.
Okay, Mrs. Morvai, that's not a point of order. I very much agree with you that the empty room or the absence of many colleagues is very deplorable. However, I do not think that because we are very few to ask questions that we are wrong to ask questions. I think it's very important that it's done. I also know that these sessions are being watched live via web stream by many, many people. You've also heard that our previous guest speakers were very grateful for the opportunity to get a podium to tell their story. So I think it is important work that we are doing here, and I have no intention of cancelling the meeting. As a matter of fact, we're going to start now. I welcome our guest speakers and the rapporteur. I'm going to introduce you, but first I'm going to explain the organization of the meeting this afternoon, because we're going to change it a little bit, and I can imagine that there are colleagues who are going to be unhappy. If so, you can kill me. We've all agreed that we're going to work this way, but I'm happy to take the responsibility. It's like this, and if I look at the room, it's not going to be a problem for the time being. Only the rapporteur and the shadows are going to ask any questions, and I'm happy, Mrs. Morvai, that you would speak on behalf of the non-aligned members, given that you're also the only non-aligned present here, so you'll get the floor. So only the rapporteur and the shadow rapporteurs and Mrs. Morvai, you'll get 2 minutes maximum to ask a question, and I'm really going to be brutal. Where's the hammer? Here it is. Then the speakers are going to get a maximum of 2 minutes to respond to the questions, and then you can get a follow-up question for a maximum of 1 minute, okay, and an answer of 1 minute. So we'll have a max of 6 minutes per speaker. That's the only way that we're going to get relevant questions, relevant answers, and that we'll also be able to finish on time. And of course, if there is time left, then other members can also get the floor. That's self-evident. I should have said that. But I know this is not a very nice arrangement, but it's the only way that we can get a meaningful debate here, because last time people were a bit frustrated that they asked questions and then there were no answers. So, having said all that, I'm grateful to welcome here, first of all, Mr. Geert Standaard, who's the Vice President of the Service Delivery Engine Belgacom, and Mr. Dirk Liebaert, Secretary General of Belgacom. I'm also welcoming, for the second round of questions, Mr. Frank Robben of the Commission de la Protection de la Vie Privée Belgique, who's the co-rapporteur on the dossier Belgacom. I'm afraid that I'm not welcoming Mr. Loban. I hope I pronounced his name correctly. This is a bit the policy of the empty seat. Previously, representatives of the US government and the Dutch government have also refused to be here, and I think it is deplorable that governments are not willing to be held to account by the European citizens. So I'm not going to delay this any further. I'm going to invite, in this order, Mr. Standaard and Mr. Liebaert to do their short introductions, and then we'll get to question and answers. Mr. Standaard, you have the floor.
Meneer de voorzitter, geachte leden van de commissie.
Chairman. Sorry, Madam Chair. Got off on the wrong step. On the 16th of September, Belgacom made it known that there was an extensive operation concerning its IT security following a digital hack that Belgacom was made aware of. In the following days, this cyber incident became known as a quite broad-ranging incident and was spread in the press. Belgacom would like to thank you for the invitation to be here today, and we would like to give a brief overview of the incident itself to be able to then be able to field questions, and in doing so to allow the debate to thrive in this debate. If I may just point out the, or recall the chronology. On the 21st of June this year, the Belgacom expert sounded the alarm when it was noted that there were anomalies in the IT network in Belgacom had been subjected to malware. Then we had Fox IT who came in as experts who worked together with the Belgacom experts to look into the incident thoroughly. The initial conclusions on the 12th of July showed that there'd been a digital attack in which a complex and unknown, previously unknown virus had entered the Belgacom IT system on the 19th of July. Belgacom took a case to the federal prosecutors in Brussels. The investigation was started straight away with the computer crime unit and the state security services. Belgacom provided every assistance to the inquiry, and we intend to carry on that and have employed external specialists to help out. Our initial focus was to look into the what the virus was and to try and map what sort of virus it was. We wanted to look at whether there were problems with customers being affected or customer data having been compromised. There were no proof of those, however. The virus was only found in the internal IT network of Belgacom and therefore not in the Belgacom telecom network, the mobile network, nor the fixed line network. The database of customer information didn't seem to be compromised either. Extra surveillance was put in place to follow this up to see if anything there were any developments. The experts involved tried to bring about a remediation strategy to bear, and the knowledge that came to light between the middle of July and September were essential to be able to localize and eliminate the virus. We worked together with Fox IT, specific scanning and cleaning tools, which were developed to do that. When it appeared that these tools were indeed successfully tested, on the 4th of September, the green light was given for a fundamental cleanup operation that took place over the weekend of the 14th and 15th of September. To give you an idea, the Belgacom network is comprised of about 26,600 IT systems and the 124 IT systems where malware was actually found. This has been replaced or dealt with in another way. We carried out this operation after carrying out thorough preparation. You can imagine that you had to be meticulous in the way that you approach this in the sequencing, and that is an operation that we managed to carry out. There was no effect on customers nor service provision. And since then, we've had intensive monitoring in place, and it's part of our extended prevention plan. Our complete IT network is being continually scanned to detect new malware attacks. Since the cleanup to date, there have been no infections that have been established, but we will remain vigilant looking to the future. Belgacom is working on the legal investigation. We hope in the longer term there'll be light shed on this as to who it was who did this and their motives. At the moment, we do not have any objective elements to confirm or deny any of the speculations that has been reflected in the press reports. We're happy to answer questions you might have. However, we are not in a position to provide information that is covered by the pending legal investigation. And seeing as there is a legal investigation, it is before the courts in Brussels. You'll understand we can't give you that sort of information because it could compromise the legal investigation. And finally, we can't provide any information that might have any impact on the safety of the IT system of Belgacom. And given that, we are very happy to field any questions you might have.
Dank u wel.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Standaard. Then the next one to take the floor, Mr. Liebaert, Secretary General of Belgacom.
So I have nothing to add to the statement of my colleague. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That leaves us much more time for questions and answers. First one is our rapporteur, Mr. Moraes, for 2 minutes.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Standaard and Mr. Liebaert. I've got to thank you both. Let me begin with the legal case. I mean, first of all, to thank you both for coming. It's obvious from the fact that you've reported after the internal investigation your findings to the Belgian prosecutor. What we are doing here is we are investigating the allegations in Der Spiegel today, and we want to find out as much as we can as to how compromised Belgacom has been, and then we want to try and find as much information as we can. Now, we appreciate you can't say much about the legal case, but if you have reported to the Belgian prosecutors, that means there is a prima facie case. Otherwise, you couldn't report to the Belgian prosecutors. So can you tell us what that simple case is? Clearly, there was a digital attack, there was a hacking, but how proximate is that to what was reported in Der Spiegel? So are the allegations true or are they not true, in your opinion? And can you give us some sense of that? Secondly, the Belgian Prime Minister talked about a violation of your public firm's integrity. Can you comment on how serious you think this incident has been for your firm's integrity, and give us some sense of where you would pitch that situation? And I think we are looking for a sense of how you feel your company has been compromised, given that this is a situation where Belgacom is a major company with integrity, but it also serves the European institutions, and how you feel that has compromised your company in serving these institutions as well as serving the infrastructure in Belgium.
Thank you. I'm going to be really strict today, so if you overrun your time, it will be deducted from your follow-up question. You have 2 minutes for answering.
Als u mij toestaat, mevrouw de voorzitter, zal ik misschien eerst...
With your permission, Madam Chairman, perhaps I could start by replying to the points regarding the judicial inquiries. Now, it is the case that in Belgium, when a telecom operator reports an attack on its IT system, there is a requirement to report this to the legal system. We did so as soon as it was established that there was indeed an organized attack underway on the integrity of our system. Now, the fact that we lodged such a complaint in no way implies that we as a firm are casting aspersions at any particular attacker. In the Spiegel, that they may be setting out particular scenarios, but we as a firm would not speculate on the identification of the attacker. It's up to the judicial authorities to make the necessary inquiries and establish who is behind this.
Met betrekking tot uw vraag.
Then, in reply to your question regarding European institutions, what I could tell you is that up until now, we found some malware on our internal IT system. Of course, there is a firm firewall between our internal system and our network systems. The final network. So there's no malware on our overall network such as would affect our users. So there's no evidence that they have been affected. Might I just add that the elements of the attack were subject to legal secrecy until the 24th of September. Thereafter, we were able to report a number of points to the relevant body. We were talking about the signature of the traffic and the external IP address used for the intrusion. We informed the regulator of this, as well as the federal police.
Zijn die ook meegedeeld?
And all the relevant Belgian bodies. We've also informed .eu, which is responsible for the safety of all the European institutions. So your authorities are aware of what needs to be done to check whether your systems might have been undermined by the same malware. What we found is that there's been no overflow of malware from our internal system to our customers, and by the same token, presumably not to European institutions either.
Follow-up question? Are you satisfied? No? Okay, that brings us to the shadows. Mr. Vos, for 2 minutes.
Thank you, and thank you also for your statements. In your last answer, you already partly answered my question. I'm not that well versed in technology, but as far as I'm able to follow, if data are hacked into and sent on, can you follow what happens to the data, and also what sort of quality of data can be obtained? Are we talking about connection data, or are we talking about content data? And as to the suspicion that this attack emanated from the United Kingdom, has any information come to you to that effect, or do you have your information from the media alone?
Meneer Standaard, meneer Liebert.
Ja, ik kan u bevestigen dat er dus geen enkele...
Well, I can confirm that there's been nobody who has approached us at all. And we can only base our knowledge on the facts. And to date, there is no indication that would lead us to any perpetrator nor any motive for the attack.
Yeah. Okay, you want a follow-up question?
Also, so dass man im Grunde auch davon ausgehen.
So one could assume that other countries could account for this attack, not going on what was in the paper. And also my question about the quality of the data. Can you say something about the quality of the data? Are these things that really impinge on privacy, or are we just talking about data relating to connections made? I'm not sure exactly about the composition of this malware.
Waar we vandaag voor meer...
Well, given the current information that we have at our disposal, there are no anomalies that have been established concerning accessing network information nor anything going through our networks. So the anomalies have only been established on our side in the internal IT network. So Windows servers, for example, typical office applications that are used by our internal staff. And concerning your first question, the origin of this intrusion, well, there are no facts that can give us any indication of who could have done this. and what they wanted to do.
Okay, thank you. Today, in contrast to the previous session, I will just take my own Alde place in the order of shadows, if you don't mind. I'll put the question in Dutch. Allereerst, u zegt de inbreng.
First of all, you're saying that Welcome experts were the ones who spotted the intruders. Is that actually the case, or was there outside help with the EU? And then you say you're not sure who they were and what they were after. But is this a similar pattern to what happened in 2011, where we found that systems within the EU institutions, including the European Parliament, had been affected? Could we not draw the conclusion that the British Secret Services were involved in both instances? A third question. You say there's that on the 14th, 15th of December, there was a big clearing up operation, and now everything's clean. Is that actually the case? What do you make of reports that the Cisco core routers are still infected by malware? And we heard that from Cisco in the European Parliament. Then, 4.3, why was it that last week, Welcome, voted for sending Armix data so that it's accessible to the US? And then, why is the code name for the British Secret Services might be called Operation Socialist?
Okay, dus met betrekking tot uw eerste vraag.
Well, in reply to your first question, yes, indeed, it was Belgacom experts who discovered this had happened. Of course, our Belgacom experts did work together with our suppliers, HP and Microsoft. We established that we're talking about malware together with them, but we triggered this to our subcontractors. We brought in Fox IT, the specialists in the area. Then we were able to categorize the malware and establish that it was a highly sophisticated type of malware. Your second question regarding what was found in the European institutions, my colleague, the information was sent to CEFT EU should indicate whether or not this is identical to the intrusions in 2011. We have no information on that at all.
And dan kan ik ook nog bevestigen met betrekking tot u.
Then on your next question, the fact is that up until now, everything does seem to be clean. We're constantly monitoring the system, but all our IT systems do seem to be clean. We haven't found any traces of malware on our network, and that applies to the Cisco router, amongst others. And then on your IMIX question, that really doesn't ring any bells with us. You may have voted for that. We took no initiative on it. Mr. Lintveld, well, I'll show you the list after the meeting.
En dan nog eens uw laatste.
And then your last point was on the code name Socialist that was mentioned in Der Spiegel. Well, there we should recall that the story in Der Spiegel is just one of the possible hypotheses. It's not one that we can exclude, nor is it one that we can confirm.
I have no follow-up questions. Shadow for the Greens, Jan Albrecht, for 2 minutes.
Thank you very much. First of all, let me say that it's absolutely unacceptable that there's no representative by the GCHQ and that the UK government is answering in such an unacceptable manner. I think we should call on all national governments of the European Union to react to this immediately, because I think that it's not about national security and their application in member states. It's about an extraterritorial aggression inside the European Union. And that has to be answered. And that has to be also elaborated here in the European Parliament. And I think we should insist on this being a matter of further discussions. Then to my questions. First of all, thank you for being here. I have one very detailed question with regard to your internal IT security systems. Could you elaborate in what way there have been effects inside the internal IT systems which you refer to? So what has been compromised there exactly? And are there also subsidiaries like your own service BICS involved in those those activities which could be affected? And are you, as you are main shareholder of this daughter service, I would like to ask if you know that the BICS also offers other services, and which services, for example, to the European Parliament, to the Commission, or to the NATO. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Standard, Mr. Liebert.
Ik zal misschien eerst,
well, perhaps I can answer your question on BICS first, which is a Belgacom subsidiary, where they are meant to ensure good language and communication services between the different networks at an international level. That means that the service of BICS, voice, SMS, roaming and others, if you like, provide the link between the 100 operators that you'll find spread around the world. The customers of BICS do not include the European Parliament nor the European Union. They are operators. One of the customers is Belgacom. So we're not just a shareholder of BICS, we're also a customer of BICS. And BICS used to be an integral part of Belgacom. It used to be an internal department of Belgacom. And it's only since August 2004 that it's become a separate subsidiary. So you might say that there are still links between the IT network of Belgacom and the IT network of BICS. And indeed, we did find malware present in Belgacom and in BICS. To give you an answer to the possible follow-up question as to whether BICS was the actual target or Belgacom, we really do not know. And that's something we cannot say then in any certainty today. Maybe I can just add to that, that we don't know how this intrusion took place. To date, we have no indication of how that was done. And what I can say on where the malware was, it was only on the internal IT systems, and there's a clear partition between the internal IT systems and the networks. Of course, we checked our networks. There was no malware present there. We haven't found any malware to date there, so it's internal IT systems. Typically, we're talking about office applications, that sort of thing, that is used internally. We have more than 26,000 systems, as I mentioned. We have these Windows servers and a number of workstations, PC stations, where we did find malware, and there are 124 where it was found, so, and 60 or 70 PCs.
Just one short follow-up question, which is a bit more general. Think it would be proven that this aggression, this illegal access to your information systems, was coming from the GCHQ? How do you think that would affect your business? And would you think that it would be acceptable that the Belgian government doesn't act against the United Kingdom with regard to such an infringement of your integrity? Thank you very much.
Well, in it is a speculative.
Well, that's a very speculative question, isn't it? Which means that my answer will have to be fairly cautious, but maybe I can just point out to you the statement that was made by the Prime Minister that this incident was something that we knew about, but the reports in the press claimed that they know who was behind it. And if that were the case, that we understood who was behind it, of course, Belgium would react strongly.
That brings us to the ECR, no representative present. That brings us then to Mrs. Ernst Frogue, 2 minutes.
Ja, vielen Dank.
Thank you. 3 questions. Before I ask them, let me just say this is a question of the integrity of the telecoms infrastructure in an entire country which is being affected. I think we need to emphasize the scale of it.
Nicht nur verbriefte Rechte, die angetastet wurden, sondern
now, I'm talking about a loss of trust on the part of citizens when the law is broken like that. But I think we need a very thorough analysis of the situation, and we shouldn't remain at a superficial level. 3 questions. Firstly, the hacking technology. In the Spiegel, Quantum Insert, QI, is the software named. What do you know about this program? Is it a software program? Who made it? What sort of information do you have on it? I'd like to hear. The second point, I'm not very happy with what's been said about who's affected. You've said, okay, the customers weren't affected, it affected the internal IT. Well, I can understand what you're saying, but I've read since 2010 we've seen espionage attempts on this level. So what sort of effects have there been on your own internal systems? What sort of damage has been inflicted? How do you assess the situation? You went to a court about it ultimately, and also you talked about a contingency planning or an intervention plan. Can you say something about that? Are you sure that everything's more secure and everything's being checked? Can you say something about that more specifically?
Mr. Liebert.
Met betrekking tot de software zelf.
On the software itself, what we can tell you that we are dealing with a highly sophisticated piece of software. And we can say that the people who've developed this software obviously had a very broad range of possibilities and abilities and a lot of expert knowledge. It was highly sophisticated software, which means that the hackers, I'm sure, have considerable resources behind them. On the reference you made to 2010, we discovered the virus at the end of June, and we took all necessary measures straight away. The exact date when this was first established in our IT systems is not easy to work out, and this is being looked at by the judicial inquiry.
Dus wat dat preventieplan betreft is het zo dat we daar.
On the prevention plan, we do need a lot of information, and the some of the information we have is not necessary things we can pass on to you, but I can tell you that we do benchmark with the other telecom operators, and so we do exchange best practices that exist at the moment.
You want a follow-up question?
Ja, glücklich macht mich das nicht. Ich würde schon gerne wissen, was Sie unter.
Well, I'd like to know what you mean by a highly developed software. I'd like to hear a little more analysis of that. And when it comes to a prevention plan, I'm not looking for every last detail, but I think you owe us a bit more of an answer. And I'd be happy if you could try and do that.
Wat ik kan zeggen, dat is dat.
What I can tell you is that what we found, we cleaned up. There are two methods by which we found the malware. We shut off both those channels, and we've now stepped up our monitoring, made it more intensive than it had been hitherto. The hitch is that as a telecom operator, we all have the duty to ensure that our networks are protected properly at all times. What we're having to cope with today, and I think this sheds a somewhat different light on this incident, is that there's an intruder here who used extremely sophisticated methods, clearly has massive resources available. And even if your systems are decently protected, you cannot help but note that you cannot provide 100% guarantee against someone who has that level of resources and that level of commitment to break into your system managing to do so. And that gives rise to the debate as to how you actually protect your network as a firm. The responsibility for this cannot be laid solely at the door of the firm. Rather, we need an overall approach whereby we take account of all possible measures for prevention and repression of such acts. The directive which you recently adopted regarding network and information security is already a step in the right direction, but we do indeed need to investigate whether locally, nationally, and Europe-wide, we might need to provide more resources to the relevant authorities, including the surveillance services, the secret services.
Much then, Mrs. Morfai, for 2 minutes.
Thank you very much. We are here today because, according to the press, the United Kingdom National Security Agency attacked the Belgacom system and thereby violated the rights of you as a firm and your customers, including European Commission, European Council, European Parliament. The representatives of Belgacom said that it has not been established as a fact that the perpetrator was the British National Security Agency. Of course, it wasn't. As a criminal lawyer, let me tell you that there's nothing surprising about it. That's what criminal proceedings are for, that the perpetrators are going to be found through investigations, through evidence gathering, and so on. In modern criminal proceedings, the victim of crime has usually a very strong position. What is your position as Belgacom, as a victim of the crime, and obviously as representing the individual victims, your clients? What is your position in this investigative procedure, and what kind of motions have you made so far in order to find the perpetrator? And do you not feel that it's your role as a victim, through your lawyers, through your technical specialist, to substantiate or not the perpetrator's identity? And I ask my colleagues here, why not the European Parliament and the other European entities represented in this proceedings by lawyers, backed by technological experts, when we keep talking on other meetings of the European Parliament about victims' rights, fortunately, all the time. And victims' rights are important things. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. You have natuurlijk groot gelijk wanneer u.
Of course, you're quite right in saying that there is a major responsibility here for the victims too. And that is precisely why we are offering our full cooperation to the legal inquiries underway. Now, if you ask what are your rights as a victim in this procedure, we have launched an official complaint as the injured party, and that gives us certain rights, not at this stage of the investigation, but later on, once whoever is involved is formally charged, then Belgacom will have right to access to the documents. So that's how our legal procedures work in Belgium. We as victims have rights, and we fully intend to wield them.
Mrs. Morvay?
And do you feel morally and legally obliged to sort of collect all your resources in terms of technology, all your experts and all your partners in the international world to be present in this case? I'm very surprised, by the way, that at this stage of the proceedings you have no rights to make motions and so on. It's quite surprising to me, and I imagine that there is this prosecutor with the perfect legal knowledge, obviously, but very little technological knowledge. So in this particular case, there's a lot of technological knowledge necessary, and you have that, and your partners have that, so you should be very active in this case, I believe. Don't you feel so?
Absolutely. Ding da bang.
Yes, indeed. I think we do have a huge moral responsibility to ensure that the perpetrators are brought to book. Now, the fact that at this stage of the investigations we don't have full access to everything that's going on, there is nothing unusual. We will obtain access to the documents at a later stage, so we're not worried about that. What we're doing at this point is offering full cooperation, and the external experts that we use for our own internal purposes have been made available to the courts. So we're doing everything we possibly can to help the legal system to bring some clarity into this case. And for our own needs, as well as for our clients and our peers, as you quite rightly point out, we think that is absolutely vital. Thank you.
Thank you. I have five more requests for the floor, but before I get to the others, I would like just one clarification. After all the questions and answers, it's still not clear to me, as is reported in the media, whether or not the one who breached the integrity of your system has been able to listen in to telephone calls, yes or no, telephone calls in the European Parliament, yes or no. Because if the answer is yes, then Mrs. Morvay is absolutely right that we too are a party in this lawsuit.
Daar kunnen we formeel zijn. Daar is geen enkele aanwijzing.
I can give you a formal assurance that there's been no reason to suppose that up until now.
Your answer, we'll keep that in mind. Okay, I have five requests for the floor, minute and a half each, because that will allow us to also get proper answers. But I'll first take three questions and answers, and then two questions and answers. So the first three will be Mrs. Romero-Lopez, Mrs. Gomez and Mr. Klaas, each for a minute and a half. Mrs. Romero-Lopez.
Thank you. I'd like to ask you whether the virus, the malware, which people haven't actually named, is if it's all that sophisticated, it would surely be helpful to know exactly what this technology looks like. I'd like to know whether the technology they've used to infiltrate your internal systems was to allow them to act without being seen, or actually to, do they just want to spy on you, or did they actually want to destroy your systems? What was the sense behind this malware, and if you hadn't noticed it before, how long do you think it had actually been working?
Ms. Gomez?
First of all, I'd like to also register that I find extremely cynical, disingenuous, un-European, and actually anti-European, the answer provided to us by the British representative. It's not about British national security, it's about European security or insecurity. And in other times, had we not the EU, accusations of spying from one power into another would lead to war. This is serious. My questions now, did this attack, this intrusion, really impinge on the privacy, be it of your officers in your internal IT systems or your customers, if not by phone, by mail, text messages? What, second question, what was the in your opinion, the objective of the intrusion of this malware sparing? Just spreading the malware maliciously or actually some objective, such as to divert and migrate information from your internal IT systems into other internal IT systems, for instance, located in the GCHQ?
Thank you. Mr. Klaas, last one in this round for a minute and a half.
Yeah, thank you, voorzitter. Ook ik...
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I'd also like to make it clear once again that it's unacceptable for UKREP to refuse to appear before this committee. Of course, national security is the responsibility of the Member States, not the European Union, and I'm the last person to contest that state of affairs, but I think it is evidence of cynicism that they're hiding behind the principle of subsidiarity to avoid giving any account of themselves for any hostile act on the part of one Member State against another. Now, my question to Belgacom is this. Will this event lead to a review of your existing procedures? You've called on outside firms to elucidate what's happened. Do you have any plans to make more extensive use of these outside firms who appear to have more expertise than Belgacom, which is actually something of a scandal in itself? Are you going to get them involved on an ongoing basis so that you can act more expeditiously whenever instances of malware occur? Thank you, gentlemen.
Yeah, met betrekking tot
on the first question on malware. Our hypothesis at the moment is that this malware was not designed to destroy data. We have no indication that the service provision was ever compromised, and to date we have no indication that any customer data was compromised. As to how long that malware had been present, at the end of June we managed to establish that the malware was there, but the exact date when this first occurred is still part of an ongoing investigation, and in technical terms it is a rather complicated affair, so at the moment we cannot say anything on that front. The second question concerning the internal privacy. We found no malware on our databases for customer data. We found no malware in our network server. It was just internally. So at the moment we have no indication that the internal privacy should have been violated. As to the reason behind this attack, we can't really draw any conclusions from the facts at the moment. On the revision of current plans, I can say that at Belgacom, security is our highest priority, and that means on an annual basis, obviously we have a budget, we will continue to professionalize our expertise, and this incident meant that we are now better placed to understand how more sophisticated malware works, and I'm of the firm conviction that we will come out of this crisis that we regret, but we will come out of this crisis stronger. We will have drawn the lessons. We're already incorporating those lessons in our future plans, and we can say that a number of actions that we had initially planned are going to be speeded up.
Okay, everybody. Short follow-up from Mrs. Gomez, but really short.
Sorry, I did not get an answer to my question. Was this malware making possible that indeed the data in your internal ITs be copied, transmitted, migrated without damaging them in your ITs to another IT, say, allowing, for instance, I don't know, someone in the GCHQ to be listening to, you know, the wife of a high official of the EU
okay.
is going
okay,
out?
Okay, question is clear. Question is clear.
Yeah, dus daar opnieuw.
Well, once again, we don't have any factual information that we can draw on to make any statement on that question.
In other words, we can neither deny nor confirm. But if you could deny, then you could also just say so. Anyway, then I have one last request for the floor because Mr. Schluter has left. Mr. Billet, a minute and a half.
Thank you, well, voorzitter, and
thank you, Chairman. Thank you for allowing your welcome to extend beyond the committee to the ITRE committee. Yes, listening to what you've had to say, we're a bit worried. You're saying that the perpetrator has access to the sort of resources that means there is nothing can be done against them attacking. So in the future, that might happen again, and all you can do is just clean up ex post. You mentioned that there are national rules that need to be tightened up, and maybe at European level that could be done. Maybe you could flesh that out. If I understand correctly, this is only something that we'll be able to resolve at a higher level. And when I say higher level, it's if we join forces. How can that pan out in reality? Are we talking about at the level of your company or further? What about the investigative services, secret services? How can we do something at the European level to make sure that this sort of thing doesn't happen again, if that is at all possible? Well, indeed. That is an extremely pertinent question, because I think what we can do as a company is to make sure we have an adequate protection of our IT systems. And that's an iterative process. We want to improve in an ongoing way. We draw our lessons from what has happened. We exchange views and best practices with other operators. So there are structures in place to improve things. What we can note is that today the protection of economic interests in Europe, if I can put it that way, is not necessarily always the highest priority, in as much as the resources which are necessary to make sure we have a decent cyber policy or anti-cyber crime policy be framed, those resources aren't always stumped up to the right extent. And this is something that we as a company, and if I'm talking about this, it's a question of an attack of such complexity and such a high level with so many resources behind it. This is something that you as a company, we as a company on our own cannot resolve. Now, I know that there is no company, no authority in the world who is completely 100% immune or risk-free from this sort of attack. And that's something that we need to bear in mind. And the approach that needs to be pursued means that we do indeed have to consult and discuss and cooperate. Of course, we need to have a whole raft of measures, from the preventative to the punishments that should be in place. And so there, I think we have to have that debate to see what specific measures might be necessary, might be useful for companies, for authorities as well, and even at European level that could be put in place. But as you say, can you have an armory against this sort of attack? Well, regrettably, I have to note that there is a level of attack that no single company or authority would be able to withstand on their own.
Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of our session. I have to say, in conclusion, I'm actually a bit more puzzled now than I was at the start. So this is a massive attack by an actor who looks very much like a state, or in any case an organization with sufficient resources for a massive attack, but only the internal systems of Belgacom were affected. So why then is it a major incident that has to be reported, and why, if it's only the internal systems, then why can you not deny or confirm that data were migrated? So if you're saying that no telephone calls were intercepted, then why is this more than just an internal Belgacom matter? And why would Belgacom internal systems be the target of a third country? That escaped me, but I also understand that there is a lot more that you cannot say because it's all sub judice. And I hope that in the future we'll get more clarity about this. In any case, we're very grateful that you wanted to come here and give very detailed answers to our questions, and I hope that if in the future there are more questions, we can invite you again. So thank you very much. And that brings us to the end of this part of the session. Then we move on to the second part, and as I said, Mr. Loban, the Director of Government Communications Headquarters, otherwise known as GCHQ of the United Kingdom, has declined to come. I think you all got the letter, so you have got the reasons why. So then we immediately go to Mr. Frank Robben, the Belgian Data Protection Authority, called the Commission de la Protection de la Vie Privée Belgique, who is the co-rapporteur on the dossier Belgacom. You have the floor for a short introduction.
Yeah, ik zal heel kort zijn.
I'll keep this very brief, in line with your request. There are three points I'd like to make. First of all, what we have been doing as the Belgian Privacy Committee, and then perhaps I'll take this opportunity to suggest what lessons you may learn from our work Europe-wide. We, as a Privacy Committee, have been entrusted with the task of establishing whether the security measures attached to our systems are adequate, keeping track of advances in technology and so on. Now, once we were informed of this incident, we enjoyed strong cooperation from Belgacom. We looked into a number of confidential internal documents. And of course, we respect commercial privacy. I can only confirm that as soon as the facts became known, there was a very professional approach. The proper action was taken to prevent any further damage and to react to the course of events. Everything we've seen up until now suggests that there doesn't appear to have been a massive compromising of personal data. So much then for the Belgacom element. Now, moving into a European context, if I might be bold enough to make a couple of suggestions, I do hope that you won't scare people off ICT by attacking on too wide a front. We need ICT in a whole range of sectors. From a number of questions from speakers, I think we can perceive a need to work out a European strategy for cybersecurity. This isn't something that we should just leave to individual member states. We don't want people ending up in circumstances where they don't really know what's going on. We need a strategy that can be properly implemented. Legal steps are one thing, but what's far more important is to ensure that we have a number of operational agreements. We've seen certain patterns of malware and so forth. There may be other systems being attacked at present with the same patterns. We ought to be able to tackle them more effectively. As Mr. Bellet had said, you need to package your measures. If you ever want a solution, if you really want to find out where the attack is coming from, then we need proper technological competence to be able to analyse what's going on. I don't think we have enough in Belgium on our own to have the best chance of success. We as a national privacy body don't have that much prospect of being able to call upon highly sophisticated technologies to investigate exactly what is going on. And that's why I would put it to you, we had an opportunity to discuss this with the chair on an earlier occasion, please do focus on the international element. Please concentrate on those things that cannot be best done by the member states. There are certainly certain security issues that can be resolved nationally, but on those problems which roam beyond national borders, this cybercrime, we do need effective action. We don't have any European bodies at present who are able to take effective, prompt action with adequate tools up until now. I'll be happy to field any questions there may be.
So that brings us to our rapporteur for 2 minutes, Mr. Moraes.
Thanks, Mr. Robin, for coming. I don't know if I picked that up correctly, but you seem to be fairly dismissive of the Belgacom investigation. You have the powers, perhaps, to look into the investigation. Can you give us some more information as to what powers you actually have and how in-depth your investigation can actually be? This session, just to remind everyone, needed to have Cyrille Lauban or a representative from UCREP to build a circumstantial case for all of us. We don't have subpoena powers. We rely on people to cooperate with us. This inquiry just depends on cooperation. So we needed to have two sides of the story. Our colleagues from Belgacom can simply give us the information that they want to give us in terms of cooperation. But on their side, they have a prima facie case because they've given a case to prosecutors. That means there is a case. Now, we don't have the extra part of the jigsaw, which is the British part of it, because we don't have Cyrille Lauban and we don't have any representatives of UCREP, so we don't have a British part of it. We also put you into this session because we felt that there was some element of investigation from Belgium, an extra independent part of the investigation. So please tell us if you have any powers here or if you have any thoughts on what you think of the Belgacom case, any ideas of where you think the case is going. We understand you want to talk about the wider issues of cybersecurity, but give us your impressions of what you think is happening here. I think I heard you say that you didn't think there was a big data protection issue here, a big cyber threat. I'm not sure if my colleagues heard that, but please just expand on that and give us your overall view.
Okay, so, dus zoals gezegd.
Well, as I was saying, I'm in the Belgian Privacy Commission, and it's our remit to investigate whether personal data, particularly citizens, customers' personal data, were compromised. And we have no powers to investigate where the attacks come from and what exactly happened. But on the basis of the information we've obtained, and we had access to all the necessary documents and systems, I can confirm that on the basis of our current knowledge, there are no indications that citizens or Belgacom customers' data were massively attacked or illegally transferred. The personal data doesn't appear to have been taken. Apart from that, there are other bodies, the the courts and the security services who can deal with this. But that's not our role. What we have to do is establish whether citizens and Burgercom clients' data were compromised. And as I say, as things stand today, that appears not to be the case.
I didn't want to misunderstand your role. I just wanted to just confirm that we'd invited you because you would have given us that extra dimension of independent scrutiny and an answer on whether you felt independently that Belgian citizens had been compromised. You've given us your answer. I can see that it's caused a little bit of confusion and consternation. Well, at least I can speak for myself. You've given us your answer, so that's mine.
Okay, for the EPP, Mr. Vos, for 2 minutes.
So wie ich Sie verstanden habe.
As far as I've understood this, citizens aren't yet affected. We should therefore concentrate on international aspects. In the context of this whole NSA PRISM affair and the United Kingdom, it may be that we haven't got any information as yet, but there, in my view, must be an international dimension. If you have certain notions about the international aspects, what are those international aspects? What sort of measures are envisioned? Can we deduce that customers are affected, and what might lie behind all this?
Ik heb het al voor een stuk aangegeven, hè. Ik denk.
Well, I think I said this to a degree, that we as a national control organ, we are in place to note that we can do our job in this particular sphere, but I think it is absolutely necessary. As I've already said, these are extremely complicated viruses, encryption technologies, which at national level are difficult to decipher. And you have to decipher them to know what they actually do. If you need that level of competence and knowledge, then that's not something that any old member state could do. It means that there has to be some sort of European competency centre to do that. You know, if there's an attack on Belgacom, you know, there might be an attack somewhere else. It could be the same sort of attack. You can see the patterns that emerge because of malware being used. But if it only happens at Belgian level, then you can't really do that. So measures need to be taken to make sure that if there are these sort of attacks, that we know that there may be other forms of system that are attacked. So it's absolutely necessary that there be competences found at the European level, and that there be an exchange of information, and we need to inform each other and exchange information to be able to make headway.
Yes, thank you. Okay, I will now speak as a shadow for the ALDE group. I have to say I'm getting increasingly confused by this hearing, having listened to Belgacom and having listened to the Privacy Commission. We're talking here about a massive attack, very sophisticated, I'm using your words, by a state actor that has massive means. It couldn't be just any country. It's massive, very sophisticated. However, everything is fine because there was no interception of phone calls. Your clients weren't affected. It was just the internal system. No data have been siphoned off. And yet, there is a criminal case which is secret. So, you know, it's either one or the other. Either there is a major incident here, a major incident which indeed justifies a criminal case, which justifies this hearing and which justifies much further investigations, or it's just a minor incident inside Belgacom. It cannot both be true. It is not credible that the media are reporting about something like this and they've made it all up. it cannot be all, you know, just their imagination and there being a criminal case and you saying everything is fine. This is simply not credible. And I'm very surprised at the attitude of the Belgian Data Protection Authority. I understand that you don't have the powers to investigate who was behind this and what their motives were. But to actually say, oh, well, everything is fine and we just need European legislation to tighten up our systems. No, if this is not a massive attack, if everything is not true, then we can just conclude this session and all go for a beer. But if it is true, then we need some more answers than what we got today.
Als ik daar even kan op reageren.
Well, perhaps I can come in here.
Tot heden is...
To date. Well, until this attack on Belgacom, Belgacom had always been in a position to defend itself against attacks on its system and had never been compromised. Now we have a case where we found malware on 128 systems of ours. All we can say here today is on the basis of facts, and that's what we've tried to do. We know in the press there have been a lot of rumours, but a lot of them were based on hypotheses that were unsubstantiated. We can only base ourselves on the facts, and the facts to date do not give any indication that any information from our customers was passed on to the hacker. Now, of course, there's a further technical investigation going on, and we're involved with that. Many other agencies and bodies involved as well. And as Dirk said, we are providing every assistance to those people, but we can only express ourselves on the basis of fact today. So it is a serious attack on our integrity, yes, because it's the first time ever that malware has managed to penetrate into our internal systems.
Follow-up question then. Zeer
kort op uw vraag antwoorden.
If I could just briefly get back to you on this. Yes, it is a serious attack. But because there was rapid reaction, the impact of this attack was not considerable. I think that's clear.
So then my short follow-up question to both of you would be, what could there possibly be in the internal systems of Belgacom, the internal administration, I suppose, that is of such interest to a, to the British Secret Service or any Secret Service?
Well, once again, we can proffer various hypotheses, but I'm not in a position to give any opinion on those hypotheses. Today, as of today, there is no proof or indication what the target of that cyber attack was.
So it's unclear. Mr. Yeah. Robin?
I have nothing to add.
Okay, thank you. That brings us to Mr. Albrecht for the Greens.
Thank you. Mr. Robin, I'm a bit puzzled by your answers. The way how you try to say that everything is perfect, because, we are in the middle of a crisis with regard to the application of privacy and data protection legislation also in Belgium, and you know about it. It's about the question of circumvention of Belgian rule of law and data protection laws. And I think you should be a bit more concerned as a member of the Privacy Commission in Belgium, and I do not hope that this is the attitude generally in the DPA in Belgium. My question, you rightly called for consequences needed on the European level for the investigative powers to investigate these incidents. Did the Belgian authorities, including the Belgian DPA, involve the EC3, the Europol Cybercrime Center, into these incidents and ask for their help, which is exactly what you called for? We spent millions to do exactly that on the European level. So the question is, did the Belgian authorities ask for the help of such a center And why did the Belgian DPA and the Belgian authorities didn't do if that wasn't the case?
Mr. Orban.
Ik denk dat wij perfect.
I think that we're playing our role perfectly. I've told you that the role of the Privacy Commission is to check whether the personal data were compromised. On the basis of all the information made available to us today, and we were able to look at all the measures, all the audit reports that were prepared, it does not appear that citizens' personal data have been compromised. I told you that very clearly. Now, there is an investigation underway. We're trying to establish where the attack came from, what was passed on, and so on. You need very sophisticated decrypting technology for that. Now, there's something for the Belgian and conceivably the international authorities to do on this. That's not our role as the Privacy Commission. Just like other privacy commissions, our remit is confined to establishing whether data protection legislation has been respected or not. And we believe that the steps taken by Belgacom to protect the system were good. The measures taken whenever problems occur were right and proper, and they've used all due diligence to ensure that attacks do not lead to citizens or clients' data being improperly transferred. That's the role, and we've been doing the job properly.
No, I just asked myself how you can completely exclude that in these cases personal data are completely outside. I really asked myself. I mean, you can have I don't know if that's the right word, indices or indications for that. But I don't think that if you don't know about which data have been compromised, how could you exclude that personal data were part of it? I don't understand it, really.
Mr. Robin?
Ik kan dat niet uitsluiten vandaag.
I can't exclude that, as things stand today. The data was transferred under encryption. We can't decipher that at present, but we can see how much data was transferred. And it emerges from that it wasn't a massive transfer. If you ever want to establish what data was compromised, we would need very sophisticated decryption techniques. Otherwise, we'll never find out. If we want to crack into the sophisticated encryption and find out exactly what was taken, you need the necessary skills to do that, and you need really very highly qualified specialist skills to do that. But from the figure available, we've no indication that there was a massive transfer of data from citizens or customers. As I say, that's on the basis of the information available to us today. I can't give you a 100% guarantee, no, but we have very clear indications that there wasn't that massive data transfer. The steps were taken by Belgacom.
Absent, Mrs. Ernst, on behalf of GUE for 2 minutes.
Yeah, vielen Dank.
Yes, thank you. I would just like to update what sets were affected. You said no individual company can protect itself. That was a sentence you said. And you also said national data protection agencies have little opportunity to establish what has happened, and we need some sort of European level facility. Can I ask you directly, at present, can technology be used to fend off these high-tech cyber attacks? How secure is Belgacom? That would be my question. And is the privacy of telecoms guaranteed at all, purely from the technological perspective. That's my first point. The second point, let me look at it from the other way round and ask what audits of security and Belgacom have been carried out and at what interval and what were the findings and when was the last time and moreover, who is carrying out the audits? Is it an independent body or something else? And what would you intend to do in respect of their conclusions? And if internal IT systems have been affected, and I've Spiegel about colleagues involved, have they been affected? Surely there are people within your internal systems who might have been affected. Have you detected anything in that direction?
Ze hebben ze overgelaten aan.
I will allow Belgacom to address the factual points, but frankly, I don't think you can avoid this 100%. You know, if software doesn't have elements built into it to prevent backdoors. Don't forget that there are rules and regulations in the US which stipulate backdoors. You're familiar with that. So we have no guarantee that those problems aren't going to be there. You have to carry out proper checks, but we can't completely exclude the possibility that software from outside firms contains backdoors. We can't rule that out. What we can do is adopt the necessary steps to look carefully at the risks, keep an eye on the level of technology, and keep the risk to the barest minimum. But there is no cast iron guarantee. On the other points, perhaps I could hand over to Belgacom. May I just confirm once again that securing our network is a primary concern for us. So we are working on fresh measures to be a step ahead of potential attackers. We've been partially successful. I'm thinking of some of the cyber attacks that have been launched, vendetta attacks in the past. We've managed to fend those off. As for the standards, we are up to the mark with the international ISF standards, and our data centres, as far as security is concerned, do enjoy ISO certification. So every now and then we get external auditors in to check the security system, and then we have benchmarks with a number of labs around Europe, a number of operators around Europe, and we have an ethical forum. The benchmarks look at all the various elements of security. There's more to it than just the architecture of the system, the technology. It also involves the kind of actions you take, the governance processes, the culture within any given company. And of course, we learn from the benchmarks and feed our findings into our further work. We are going to be beefing up all our measures. And so we have our own IT infrastructure in-house, but we also have an external one, which provides service to our customers. Now, where the weak link was that let the attack into our system is not yet known. Are we acting differently now? Yes, indeed. We said that we're taking a range of additional measures. We're going to be stepping up our monitoring. We've undertaken that. A technical report is being prepared now, which the Belgacom management team will receive at the end of this month. And they're going to try and learn the lessons of this crisis, and we will emerge strengthened from that.
Thank you for that. Then to conclude the round of shadows, I now count Mrs. Morvai as a shadow for the non-aligned for 2 minutes.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the representative of the Belgian Privacy Commission for coming here. I'm so embarrassed that I might have misunderstood you, and I would like to clarify. It seems that you are saying that on the one hand, it's clear that there was a major attack on the Belgian telecom company. But on the other hand, there was no harm done to the customers. So this is not a case for you. This is not something for you to deal with. And I was thinking about a parallel while you were speaking, that if somebody is shooting to the direction of a person and the bullet misses the person, then would either the victim support agency or the police say, well, why bother? I mean, what's wrong here? There was nothing has happened. The victim didn't have any harm. Maybe he or she should protect herself a little bit more from now on. I don't think that that would happen. It would be considered as an attempted murder or an attempted assault or something. So it's still a crime. So why is it not considered as such? And I have another point to make, and that is that it seems that the Belgian authorities, especially the Belgian Prosecutor's Service, definitely needs help in this investigation. And I think that the Liebe Committee and our inquiry proceeding is in the position of helping. There is a very important witness in this case, and it appears that he was not heard yet by the prosecution for reason unknown to us. It's quite obvious that Edward Snowden knows a lot about this case. Why don't we invite Edward Snowden to talk about this case through Skype? We would tape whatever he says and submit it to the Belgian prosecution as an evidence to be considered, to be dealt with. And from then on, that they would be in a much easier situation. And I think it's such a nice feeling to help others. So why don't we do that? Thank you.
Yes, thank you. I think that's an excellent suggestion. I'm sure Belgacom would like to provide a secure Skype connection with Mr. Snowden, Mr. Robin.
Yeah, sorry, as ik misschien on.
Well, I apologize if I've been unclear. There's a legal case, a legal investigation ongoing, and they're going to look into what happened, who perpetrated the crimes, and what the punishment will be. Alongside that, there's a privacy committee that has no legal powers, has no role to play, cannot impose sanctions on that front. But in terms of the way in which personal data has been used or abused, whether there's been an abuse also of privacy regulations or legislation, and to see whether we can find a better way of improving privacy protection. Those are two separate things. You have a legal investigation, and you have the privacy committee looking into things and following things up. In the privacy committee, we're looking into whether private data has been compromised. We believe that is not the case, given the evidence we have at the moment. And looking at the security measures that Belgacom took and additional measures they've taken since to avoid this in the future, we believe those to be sufficient. We've had a look to see whether the measures that Belgacom took at the time when the incident became, they became aware of the incident, whether it was sufficient action they took, and we believe that was the case. All the rest is left up to the legal investigation, where the Belgian courts have to deal with this. You haven't invited anybody from the judiciary, you've invited somebody from the Privacy Commission, and I'm giving that answer as somebody from the Privacy Commission, and I'm only there to see if there's been an abuse of privacy legislation. There's nobody from the Belgian criminal investigation, and by the way, it's a pending case, so sub judice anyway, you know, as to what the criminal case is and who did it. We don't have anybody there. I hope I have been clear between the two parallel investigations that are ongoing at the moment.
Follow-up question?
Thank you very much. I just wanted to clarify whether you consider this as a privacy case as an important case of violation of privacy, and maybe the data of customers was not were not actually compromised, but at least they were endangered. And maybe I'm not very familiar with the rules and regulations about your commission, and that's why I'm mistaken. But I have the feeling that it should be a case for you, because if your commission's role is to protect the privacy of people in Belgium, then if such a major endangerment of the privacy of people took place, then it should be a case for you. And that's it. Okay, I don't want to take more time.
Wij beschouwen dit als een zeer...
Well, we don't see it as a very serious abuse, but we do think that it is a case that's proven that it's more or less, there's a degree of safety there, because there are no indications that there's been an abuse of any privacy issues. Yes, there is a case to answer, but not for us to look into. There doesn't appear to be any compromising of Belgacom's customers' data.
I've got three more requests for the floor, but I'll first give the floor to the rapporteur, who has an additional question.
I just want to make a quick question to Mr. Robin, and to also acknowledge that we do understand that the limitations that you have, you're from the privacy element, and we understand we didn't invite somebody from the judiciary and any other organs. So let me ask you, are you aware of any other element of the Belgian infrastructure, judiciary, or anyone else who's accessed the European Cybercrime Centre, for example? Because a theme is emerging here that we set up the European Cybercrime Centre within Europol to exactly deal with this situation, and we are seeing an emerging situation here, all of my colleagues, that no one is accessing this, no member state is making this complaint, nobody is using this infrastructure. This is a theme that is a common denominator in every hearing that we have. So although you are in this section, you understand the infrastructure in Belgium. We're not subpoenaing you, we're asking you to come here in cooperation. So tell us, from your knowledge, is anyone else accessing the European Cybercrime Centre, or do they want to access it? That's what it's there for. Please tell us, and if not, why not?
Ik denk dat er de volledige...
Well, I can't speak on behalf of the Belgian Secret Services to look into this. Presumably they would take up contacts there if necessary, and I haven't asked for that to be done, but I think you need to look at the level of competence here, looking at the European level, and that's maybe something you should be looking at.
Okay, so I have Mr. Albrecht, point of order.
I'm sorry, but I just would like to note that obviously just now there's a confirmation that there are some log files that is confirmed by some journalists, which deliver quite clearly that it's the GCHQ and that it's British origin, the attack. So, I mean, I don't know if you have known about this before, but I would have expected that this is becoming true, that there's at least also from the side of the Belgian authority more openness and more direct answers
to
our questions.
You're asking the question, are you asking Belgacom to confirm this, or the Privacy Commissioner?
I mean,
both.
It's up to you if you want to say something on that, but just refer to it. And I mean, it's okay. Disappointing, but if we get at the end of our meeting such a confirmation by journalists.
Okay, I'm going to ask both Belgacom and the Privacy Commission to answer to that very briefly, and then we get to our last three questions.
Well, als datgene wat de journalist...
If what the journalists are saying is right, then it is indeed disappointing that they get information before Belgacom itself. But I must say that as things stand now, we have no indication as to who might be behind this attack.
Ik heb daar niks aan toe te voegen. Ook bij.
I have nothing to add to that. We don't have that information.
Okay. I'm going to give the floor to Mrs. Sippel, Mrs. Gomez, Mrs. Romero-Lopez, each for a minute and a half. We'll round up your three questions and then we'll come back.
Vielen Dank, Frau Vorsitzende.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I think the last debate was a little odd. Today we've heard numerous times that these attacks must have required tremendous technological and other resources, and a single company couldn't have done this. So who else but a security service could have done it? Please answer that. And if it wasn't a private company but a security service, then many legal and data protection questions are lost from sight because a security service wouldn't take those into consideration. So who then can put in place the necessary facilities to fend off such attacks if the security services of the member states themselves are involved in the attacks? Then there is no customer or personal data involved, but can we exclude, given the tremendous resources brought to bear to hack into Belgacom's internal systems, that information could have been obtained? Otherwise, why would they have made the effort? And perhaps in the medium term, this information will be used to infringe human rights or the situation of companies, including telecoms companies. So those are my questions.
Robin, you have said that you don't have evidence of any massive transfer of data. But do you have evidence of any selective transfer or copy or occasional monitoring of data, say, of my phone conversations or of the message that myself or Mr. Zoroboro sent to our grandchildren? I think this is indeed a very important precision. It's not about massive data, it's selective, occasional monitoring. And a suggestion, if nobody is activating the investigation by Europol and European Cybercrime Center, why don't we? I am a Belgacom customer. I'm ready to do it.
I'm afraid you're not a member state, Mrs. Gomez. Mrs. Romero-Lopez, for a minute and a half.
Gracias.
Thank you. In our committee, on earlier occasions, we discussed the importance of encryption in deciphering labs. Now, I'd like to know which labs are working on this in Belgium. Where is the encryption and deciphering going on in Belgium? They bear such a heavy responsibility. We ought to know who they are. And then surely they should have special certification so that we can establish whether their skills are commensurate with that responsibility. How do they actually carry out their work? Are they the same persons being used by the Americans? That's information we ought to have.
Okay, we have three questions now. I'm going to ask Mr. Robin to answer first, and then I'll come back to Belgacom in case they want to respond.
Ja, ik zal kort zijn.
I'll keep it brief. I'll take it in reverse order. Now, regarding encryption, I mentioned the point that the information which has been transferred, it's not a question of encryption by Belgacom. It's this sophisticated technology being used for the attack uses encryption. So you have to be able to carry out decryption to know exactly what data had been compromised. That's the problem. They use these encryption techniques But if you want to find out, you've got to be able to reverse the process. And that does imply a high level of technological knowledge. So it's not a question of Belgacom having done a bad job with encryption. It's all the work of the malware. Now, I acknowledge that on the basis of current information, we don't know exactly what may or may not have been compromised, but on the basis of the information available to us today, we've no indication that personal data has been compromised to any great extent. There may be some selective data, there may be some personal data involved, but on the basis of what we've been told up until now and on the basis of Belgacom's inquiries, it doesn't appear that there's been any massive transfer of customers' information from one country. We're fairly confident about that.
Somebody from Belgacom?
I can merely confirm that as things stand today, we have no facts to indicate that such transfer took place. We can see that, of course, a certain amount of information has been removed from back doors and it's been encrypted. What the target was is something that we hope we will be able to work out following further investigations. As to who carried out the intrusion, on the basis of our information, this appears to have been particularly sophisticated software. In order to develop that, you need significant resources. But who exactly is behind all this is something which, up until now, we have no solid information on. That's it.
Thank you very much. Well, you know, if it is indeed GCHQ, then they should have the expertise to help you out and decrypt. Mrs. Morva, you have a point of order. Point of order or a political point?
Do you have any problem with politics, Madam Chair? I thought I very much hope that we both believe in politics. I just want to follow up on the point of order of Mr. Albrecht. That I think it seems that whatever evidence journalists and whistleblowers provide through the press is considered to be just rumors. So why don't we provide a space and a framework for elevating the so-called rumors to the level of evidence? And as I said, in the case of Snowden as a witness, we can do it with all pieces of evidence in this Belgacom case and then tape it and present it to the prosecution service. It would not be exceeding our authority, but still a good way of helping the proceedings, the criminal proceedings in Belgium.
I'm sure that if we can get hold of that kind of evidence, we will indeed submit it to the prosecutor. I'm going to ask our rapporteur to make some concluding remarks.
Well, first of all, Chair, the big political conclusions are going to be made at the end of this inquiry, but I think for the time being, I want to thank our witnesses because they're not forced to come here. We're not subpoenaed. You come here through cooperation, and they at least said that a prima facie case was made. Now, because a prima facie case was made by Belgacom to the Belgian prosecutors in a sophisticated legal system, that means a case was made. And that means that we have to make assumptions about what that case was. We didn't make any progress on what the detail of that case was. And we can only make assumptions, as you can. But as politicians, we have to make our assumptions. We couldn't complete the circumstantial evidence because we didn't have the other side of that allegation, which was the British representative. So we were hampered in that case. And we didn't complete the case of an independent analysis from the Belgian authorities because there were limitations to that evidence. But we can make a number of assumptions. For example, we are fast learning that member states are not accessing the European Cybercrime Centre, for example, and all sorts of issues which are becoming very clear to us on this committee. So I'm not going to make the final political conclusions, but I think this was a very useful session because we asked many pertinent questions. Of course, we didn't get the clear answers, but I think we assumed that we wouldn't reach many of those conclusions. So I'm going to leave the concluding remarks there. And I want to thank every member who stayed on this Thursday afternoon to ask those questions and everyone listening on the web stream.
Okay, thank you very much. And I too, from the chair, I would like to thank our guest speakers. And you know, it's nothing personal if we made your life difficult this afternoon. At the same time, I also have to say that I think we're all coming away with more questions than answers, which is not necessarily your fault, but I think it's frustrating we don't have full powers of inquiry and the powers to hear people under oath. However, I'd be curious to know if the Belgian Parliament intends to hold a full parliamentary inquiry and ask you the same questions under oath, because indeed there is a number of discrepancies here in this case, saying we don't really know what happened, we don't really know who did it, we know it's massive, but only the internal systems were affected, therefore all the reports in the media are pure speculation, but there must be some basis, I would say. Okay, that leaves me with the only communication that the next inquiry meeting is next Monday, October 7th at 7 o'clock. The topic will be Safe Harbour, and this meeting is in Strasbourg. So thank you all for being here.
It's fantastic. So I really think that I'm really happy that at least the reporters and some afterwards for coming, because